Ministry of Stuff.
And North Carolina resident Marie Holmes won $188 million in the Powerball lottery in 2015. She must have believed that all her troubles were behind her. But like many others who have won large sums in the past and subsequently found themselves in a worse situation, she wound up becoming a cautionary tale of how money is not necessarily the answer to life's problems. In 2015, Marie was a single mother in her mid-20s, working two jobs in order to provide for her four children. She was employed by both Walmart and McDonald's. However, she was forced to quit those jobs when she was given the devastating diagnosis that one of her children was suffering from cerebral palsy. She was living in a trailer, struggling day to day and taking care of her children, when the single parent gave her mother, Fontella, money to buy a lottery ticket from a local gas station. When the winning numbers were announced, Marie was understandably shocked. She told TV news channel WECT, "I thought I was going to have a heart attack when I saw the ticket and checked it." Marie was given a choice. She could receive her winnings in one of two ways: $188 million paid out in installments of over 30 years, or a smaller lump sum of $127 million, or $88 million according to some differing reports, paid immediately. She chose the lump sum and became an extremely wealthy woman almost overnight. There are different schools of thought when it comes to Marie's decisions. Some observers believe that it would have been better to take the installments, as you're paid more manageable amounts over a period of time, which discourages frivolous spending, as your resources are limited. The installments are also contractually guaranteed, delivering a regular income stream upon which you can always rely. However, others believe it's a better option to take the lump sum and then use it wisely, usually with the help of a financial advisor. Theoretically, sound investments and a lack of overly extravagant expenditure could lead you to making more money over a 30-year period than the initial prize amount, due to compound interest. Given how Marie's life would proceed over the next few years, it's arguable that she may have been better choosing the installment options. According to financial advice website The Balance, when someone wins the lottery and takes a lump sum, it's tempting to help out family and friends who come knocking. And this is exactly what happened. The site argues that a lottery winner who's receiving installments is less likely to make the impulse mistake of generosity he or she can't really afford. Unfortunately for Marie, she was in receipt of the full amount of her win, and many of her spending decisions when it came to family and friends were highly questionable. A few weeks after she received her money, Marie used $3 million to bail her boyfriend, alleged drug dealer Lamar Hot Sauce McDowell, out of jail. Then, a few months later, in August 2016, she paid $6 million to post his bond. He'd broken the rules of his pretrial release program. Then, on New Year's Day 2016, she paid $12 million to bail him out again, and he was involved in another illegal street race. All in all, Marie paid an incredible $21 million of her entire lottery winning simply dealing with McDowell's run-ins with the law. However, he defended her decisions to the Daily Mail newspaper in a 2016 interview. He said that it was Marie's desire to stand by her man, and this meant she had no regrets about spending such a huge amount on him. He continued by saying, "We're a couple, and I'm the father of her youngest child. This is what people do for each other." McDowell, who had also been gifted a $15,000 Rolex watch encrusted with diamonds and a pickup truck by Marie, maintained that, "If I had that money, then I'd do the same for her. People are just jealous because of how much she won, and people want to see me locked in jail." Regardless of whether or not Marie was happy to spend her money on McDowell, something that can't be argued is that he was one of the main recipients of her generosity. Her level of financial responsibility can, however, be debated, and McDowell's belief that she has the money and can do what she wants with it doesn't stand up to scrutiny from many observers. McDowell spoke in his 2016 Daily Mail interview about how Marie had felt burdened by her lottery win. He revealed that she told him, "When money comes, there are problems." One such problem was the racism he says the couple endured when they moved into a new 5-bedroom property in Charlotte, North Carolina. The house was worth $294,000 and was a million miles away from the small mobile home Marie had lived in before her win. But what should have been a happy experience was the exact opposite, according to McDowell. He said, "We were the only black family on the estate, and they didn't like it." He went on to describe an example of the distrust they faced while living there. He lamented, "One neighbor set up a camera to record everything we were doing. If I was driving down the road and going at the speed limit, they'd wave at me for going too fast." This, understandably, made life there untenable. McDowell's final statement on the matter was that they did not want us there. They were prejudiced. One anonymous female neighbor who gave the Daily Mail a comment didn't deny that the family was not welcome there. She said, "If they're gone and never come back, many people will be happy." Perhaps the neighbors weren't fond of the family living there for reasons of a more criminal nature. The newspaper reported that police went to the house to check an alert for McDowell's GPS ankle monitor, which he had been wearing due to a prior drug arrest. During the visit, the officers apparently smelled cannabis in the house. When they subsequently served a search warrant for the property, which they believed to be housing money made from selling and distributing other narcotics, Marie found herself arrested on marijuana possession charges. A gun was also discovered in the master bedroom, and it was linked to McDowell, meaning he faced a firearms possession charge. Marie's drug charge eventually went away. However, this was the situation that led her to paying the $6 million bond in an attempt to limit McDowell's time in jail. There can be little doubt that, while Marie herself mightn't have been conducting illegal activity, she was a wealthy woman surrounding herself with people of a dubious nature. Even when Marie tried to do something selfless with her money, though, it still went wrong. She made a verbal promise to the pastor of her local church, Kevin Matthews, to give him $1.5 million to purchase an area of land. He wanted to use this land to open a retreat facility. Instead, in February 2016, Marie found herself on the receiving end of a lawsuit from Pastor Matthews to the tune of $10 million. He claimed she'd gone back on her verbal agreement, and though she'd paid him $700,000, he wanted her to be held accountable for the original amount they discussed. Pastor Matthews claimed that he'd suffered emotional distress and was forced to increase his dosage of antidepressants due to the argument between himself and Marie. He told Centric TV, "I just want her to do what she said she was going to do. I want peace and to do what God told me to do. I really feel like a warrior for Christ." Matthews believed someone came along and discouraged Marie from donating the entire amount to the church. He believed it may have been her aunt, who'd been appointed the chief executive of the Marie Holmes Foundation, an organization formed to pay grants to worthy groups and individuals with ambitious and creative goals. Spending obscene amounts on her boyfriend's legal bills and becoming embroiled in legal battles with her church weren't the only trials Marie faced. An appearance on the Oprah Winfrey Network show, Ayanla, Fix My Life, in October 2016, revealed possible reasons behind Marie's skewed attitude to money, which may have been born out of a troubled relationship with her mother and what the show's host described as an overall immaturity. Before Ayanla, a life coach, was able to dig into these factors, though, she first made an interesting observation about Marie's house within minutes of arriving. While the property was beautiful and sprawling, Ayanla almost immediately noted something that gave her pause. The home had a history as a plantation. "I believe that every location has an energy," explained Ayanla, "so it was important for me to help Marie recognize and understand that as a black woman living on a plantation, there was an energy she was dealing with, in addition to what was going on in her personal life." Ayanla then delved deeply into Marie's relationship with her mother, Fontella, and it yielded some shocking revelations. Firstly, even though Holmes believed the winning lottery numbers had been picked at random, Fontella told him they weren't. She had, in fact, carefully picked the numbers based on the birthday age of her third child, Marie's brother, who had died. Fontella said that she let her daughter think the numbers were random because, "I just wanted you to better yourself for the babies." Unfortunately, Marie's response was that she would rather have known her mother picked the numbers due to the pressure the money put on her. "Then it would be her and not me," she admitted. Despite this, Marie did then thank her mother for what she did, and Fontella explained that she'd do the exact same thing again if it came to it. On the TV show, she stated that, "If I could do it all over again, I'd still have did it the same way. I want you to better yourself and be the better mom than I was." Ayanla was able to dig further into the relationship between the two women. Marie revealed that she felt like her siblings were treated with more love and care than she was. She couldn't understand why Fontella would slap her in the face when disciplining her, as she wouldn't do that to her other children. Marie poured out her heart and soul by saying, "None of them ever got hit in the face, and it made me feel like there was a problem with the relationship we had, like it wasn't strong enough." She added, "I never understood, like, why did I get treated that way?" Fontella responded by saying she regretted those actions and hadn't ever thought about the effect it would have on her daughter's mental health. This prompted Ayanla to explain how devastating a slap in the face can be. She said it was the ultimate act of humiliation because your face is how you show up in the world. It's who you are. Ayanla continued, "So when someone slaps you in the face, what they're saying is, I am degrading you, I'm diminishing you, I'm humiliating you. This issue was undoubtedly something that the mother and daughter needed to work through, as Ayanla claimed it had contributed to Marie being emotionally immature as an adult. This immaturity made Marie someone who needed lots of help and guidance that she wasn't getting in order to deal with her newfound wealth, according to Ayanla. She pointed out that the state of the property, which had dirt bikes abandoned around the grounds and a filthy pool, and told Fontella that both she and her daughter needed to step up. "You the mama, correct her and direct her, and stand with her and for her," she proclaimed. "She don't have a clue. Your daughter needs you so badly." Ayanla then identified a deep sorrow at Marie's core. She told Fontella, "The depth of her sadness is heartbreaking to me as a mother, and some of that sadness is about you." Ayanla then sat down with Marie herself and told her some uncomfortable home truths. "I see the result of someone who has no concept of what it means to be an adult," she said, before adding, "Mature individuals do not behave this way, no matter how much or how little money they have." In an effort to illustrate the true cost of her immature attitude to her money, Ayanla instructed Marie to put bricks in a small red wagon, each brick identifying something she'd bought for other people. She then told her to drag the heavy wagon around, with the exercise notionally demonstrating the emotional weight of her purchases. After analyzing Marie's situation and behavior, Ayanla's ultimate diagnosis was that her problems were not caused by her windfall. She believed the money itself was not to blame and was not what was derailing Marie's life. But rather, that core issue was a problem of maturity, of self-respect, and of dignity. "A lot of this doesn't have anything to do with money," concluded Ayanla. "It has to do with broken people, with broken hearts, with broken minds. That leads to choices and decisions and consequences." All in all, she believed that money isn't a solution to life's problems, especially if those problems are buried deep within a person's psyche.